wrestling fans. It's Mr. Patterson from WrestleZone Management here. And I'm here with a little announcement I'd like to give you guys. You see, at Halloween Hijinks, we already know the main event will be a Halloween brawl with Lost Boy Aspen defending the WrestleZone Undisputed Championship against Mickey Vago. Well, I'm here with kind of another announcement, more of a teaser. You see, for the first time ever at this year's Halloween Hijinks, there's going to be two Halloween brawls. That's right, two Halloween brawls. So I ask you to stay tuned, and more announcements to follow.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Welcome to the latest edition of the WrestleZone podcast. Yes, you've heard a voice. We're going to introduce him in a moment if you listen to the audio version, although I'll probably put his name somewhere on it. This is the WrestleZone podcast, not the SWN podcast, and I'm joined with a co-host this evening for the first time. I think this is episode 8 of the show, to talk about Halloween Hijinks coming up this Saturday. I'm joined by former WrestleZone tag team champion and a competitor in several Halloween brawls, which we'll get into. It's Blue Thunder. Welcome to the show.
Hello, Billy. Thank you for having me. Hello, SWN viewers, listeners, general hangers-on. Good to be with you all.
And I promised then when I announced that you were going to be a co-host, we'll be happy. Well, I'll be happy. I won't be as curmudgeon-y and roasted.
Immediately he's frozen.
Oh, internet is unstable. Awesome. That's a good start to the show. I'm back.
At least it happened then. It's all right.
All right, that's fine. I think it'll be okay at my end. It'll just be you that's frozen, which is... it's okay. It's okay.
Wife's downstairs. I'll be getting it from you as well. So, yeah, I think right. It's just happening both ways.
That's fine. Kelly's watching Marvelous Miss Maisel, so that's probably the issue that I've got with my internet. Wonderful.
You made the best choice.
Yeah, we're going to speak about wrestling for however long it takes to go through six matches in a pre-show. Yes, okay. So... We've got you on the show finally. Listen, our last time was our 3 minutes of just whinging and saying the wrestling's probably going to be good, but we're sweating here. And
yeah,
I haven't watched it back. I felt cringed at the time when I was just like losing my just all my thoughts gone because of the heat. But now it's October, and we're going to Curl, which is it's got ice hockey, so surely it's going to be a cooler venue.
I hope. I'm not going to put money on it, but you should think so, yes. It's definitely cooler outside. We can vouch for that.
I've looked at my costume for Halloween, and I realized that I probably need to go with one that's got a jacket or at least sleeves this time.
I would.
Because last year was pretty chilly as well for Halloween, even though I went as Mickey Vago, which I'm sure he enjoyed. So, Halloween Hijinks. We're coming to Curl's sold-out show. So we're not selling any tickets to this event, but we're hopefully going to speak about it and have a good time with it. Like I say, six matches and a pre-show. We might even talk a little bit about Stonehaven if we've got the time, because a match to be announced for that event as well. So we'll see what time we've got.
Oh, loady.
If we're into the wee small hours, then we might not, but we'll take it from there. So for yourself then, sold out, Curl Aberdeen, you're going to be on comms, I assume you'll be commentary for the DVD release. We talked a little about your commentary and how you're enjoying it now, because you're not, you're getting to watch it without having to actually be physical in the ring. We said that, but about, what, 2 hours later, you were in the ring in Inverurie separating the foundation and the outfit. So it's not quite over.
Unfortunately, yes.
Which we'll definitely get into in a little bit as well. So let's just, Halloween Hijinks is a big event in WrestleZone calendar. It was the one that brought back the WrestleZone events as well following the pandemic, which is an incredible night. I think it was one of the last shows at the Northern. I think, was it Aberdeen Anarchy was the last show at that?
I believe you are correct, sir, yes.
So it's a big event for WrestleZone, one of their big five, at least their named shows. So for you, just before we get into the show itself, Halloween Hijinks is a big show for you, because not only have you been Halloween Brawls, but this event is where you won your first tag team championship as well. So as far as Halloween Brawls go, or Halloween Hijinks goes, what does this event mean to you?
Well, like you say, there was the personal milestone there a whole 10 years ago now, which I don't like to think about, but yes, that was certainly something that was, I suppose, a bucket list thing, you know, for any wrestler. You win your first championship. The Halloween Brawls, where be they a little bit on the nose and a bit more serious or a bit more lighthearted and, you know, trussing people up with Halloween garlands or whatever, they were always taxing, shall we say, in more ways than one. Halloween Hijinks, it's an event I look forward to because, like you've already alluded to, the fans get into it with the costumes and the dressing up and not knowing what to expect. For that reason, it's always a great night. Like we say, nights are drawing in, it's getting a little bit colder, but we give them a hot night of action. That's always brilliant. And the point you made about it being the first show back after the lockdown hiatus, whatever words you want to put on it, that is a special memory, because there were times we didn't know we were going to be coming back. There were times we didn't know what the future held. To be able to return, to be able to see how much the people had missed the guys, that was electric that night. That's a night I'll never forget.
So yeah, I remember that. There was a tear in my eye. I'm not sure, to quote Ric Flair. But it was one of those nights where we watched it, and of course took Kelly with me. Well, Sid took Kelly with me. She wanted to go see some wrestling as well. She'd missed it in 2 years as well, and she couldn't believe it. It's like, are you crying? It's like, I might be a little bit crying here, because I didn't think I missed wrestling as much as I did until you actually go to see it live again. You're like, my God, this is what, 10 years. I've been going to see WrestleZone since for 10 years this past June. So it's been it was a very like emotional night to go see it again. But yeah, Halloween Hijinks, we're back for it once more on Saturday the 21st. I panicked there because I've got a weekend of wrestling myself. Good start. So the 21st of October at Curl Aberdeen, which is a new venue since the return of shows, which is a really great venue as well. It's really quite intimate but also quite big at the same time, because you've got that room at the side where you can get all your merch and all that kind of stuff. It's a nice venue. It's upstairs though, which, you know, WrestleZone have got a habit of finding venues that are upstairs. As someone who is more on the crew nowadays, how is it for you for getting everything set up? Is it fairly straightforward?
Like you say, stairs always provide an obstacle, but compared to some venues that we've run in the past, it's a cakewalk. It really is. Nice wide stairs, nice wide doors. It helps, shall we say. And nice easy access for a loading van before and afterwards. So can't really complain in that regard.
I remember way back when I moaned about Fraserburgh, the Dally Hall. That was stairs were,
yeah, that's
so narrow.
Yep.
I'm just looking, going, how has this happened? How's it got a ring? How have you guys got a ring in there? But you did it. And did
that
it several
lots
times.
Lots of difficulty.
Anyway, let's get on with the show then. So we'll start with the pre-show match itself. I'll have graphics flying about before and after our chats about the actual show, along with some video portions as well, the promos building up.
Ooh, mind your head, folks.
So, I'm not that keen with the editing. It's just going to be before and after. Might fade out. That's as keen as editing as I go. So we'll start with the pre-show itself. VIP ticket holder match, triple threat, just announced yesterday as of recording. We've got Oliver Green, Chris Archer, and Tommy Raiden. This has got a little bit of backstory as well. When I was doing my notes here, we've got Chris Archer returning, first time after Aberdeen Anarchy. So it's been, what's that been, 6 months-ish, something like that. So it's been a little while. And you've got Green, Ollie Green, looking for his first win. Hasn't picked up a win on main shows. I don't know if galas, I don't know how canon in the record books galas
wrestling
shows
match
are.
Is a wrestling match.
Very true, but I don't get the results.
Take the wins
them,
when
so
you can. I know that more than anyone.
And we've got Tommy Raiden as well, who's got 6 months losing streak as well. So everyone's champing at the bit to get a win on this show. And what I've found since, again, since the shows have come back, I've always gone VIP because, you know, it's £3 extra. It's a no-brainer to pay that a little bit extra to get a VIP ticket and get an extra match from it.
Is these are £1 per wrestler this night.
That's it. And these are always very competitive matches. It's in front of, let's say, VIP. Most people go VIP now, so they're paying the extra couple pounds for it. But it's still a first chance of maybe seeing these people and your introduction to WrestleZone. And three guys that have, well, as you alluded to in Inveruri, from Elgin, well, Raiden's Ellen, Chris Archer, I've Aberdeen. I don't know. I didn't know off the top of my head. I panicked.
He's Belmedi.
So yeah, again, another.
Yeah, they are still spread out.
They're quite spread out in the Tri Counties area. So yeah, what are your thoughts on this match?
Well, I think what you're saying about the VIP bonus match is very apt. People want to see it, and there is usually a lot of action because it's guys who want to be part of that main show. They want the, you know, some people still wear that VIP bonus match as that, oh no, I shouldn't be here. I should be, you know, main event. I should be whatever. So they're trying their hardest to get that win, to get up the card and do whatever. But this is also a chance for them to shine because it's your own little window of the evening. It's your own little captive audience for that 10, 15 minutes, however long you go through things. You've got the chance to make a big impression. And for these three guys, you mentioned Green and Raiden there looking for wins after a long time. They're new guys. They're new blood. You know, they're straight out of our training academy. They've made the leap to shows. Good on them for that. They've shown enough. They deserve it. Now it's just they've got to back it up and keep going and keep plugging. And they can't get despondent. They can't let their heads drop. They've got to keep looking for that success. Last time out, you were there in Inveruri like I was. These two were in the ring along with Conor Malloy, someone very similar to them, fast-paced, younger, smaller body type, looking to excel, but with a little bit more experience, and that told on the night. Here, you've got a different proposition. Still a quicker guy, still a smaller guy in Chris Archer, in the Outcast, but he doesn't care what people think of him. He'll take that cheap shot. And it's more experience. Far more experience than I think Green and Raiden have had to deal with. Could that be very telling? Chris Archer needs a comeback win. I don't know what he's expecting here. He's been sticking things where they didn't belong earlier in the year, and I don't think he really thought about the consequences too much. We're going to see what comes for Chris Archer here.
Absolutely, and of course, last time Green and Archer were in the ring, Archer dismantled Ollie Green with a chair.
So at the training academy, I remember it well.
So I've done my research. Don't you worry. I've got this. I know what's happening.
That's right. So it's me thinking.
But yeah, it's very like exactly what you're saying. Like Ollie Green and Tommy Raiden. Also, not only they have had these matches on the VIP pre-show, but they've also like alluded to maybe trying to be a bit of a team, and they tried that at Battle of the Nations as well. It didn't go their way. They had Air Miles with them, and they got steamrolled by the outfit. But they've got so many opportunities for them now because they're so young, and I think the tag team division as well in WrestleZone is really starting to heat up again. It's starting to get lots of teams in there. So whether they can try and possibly put a little bit of ego aside for the both of them and try and concentrate on Chris Archer, like you're saying, the more experienced competitor in the match, maybe try some tandem offense, and then it'll be down to the two of them. Yes, these VIP matches, like you're saying, is their own little world. They get the moment in front of us, maybe a slightly smaller audience, but they've got a chance to make that impression. And certainly for Oliver Green, Elgin guy, so I'm from Elgin as well. So, well, I live in Elgin. So it's nice to see a hometown odd.
Some bias on the go. It's all right. We approve of that around here.
A little bit. I'm from Rothes. It's close enough. It's 12 miles down the road. Close enough. You can smell Rothes from Elgin sometimes if the wind goes right. We're not going to do predictions. I think that would be too much additional pressure that they don't possibly require. But I think everyone needs to win in this match, and I think that's going to be highly competitive in that respect as well. So. Yeah,
I'm very good at giving predictions. I'm not very good at getting them right. So yeah, we should probably skip that part.
Oh yeah, every year Regal Rumble time, I'm absolutely the worst at this time.
Not
but
playing the odds. You've got more choices that night. That's not in your favour.
That's it. When the guys ramped up to 25 entrants, I was like, oh no. This is. If I was 1-4, now I'm 1-5 getting it right. This is just terrible if I do 5 picks. So yeah, VIP pre-show. Let's move on to the next match.
The greatest wrestlers to ever wrestle in Aberdeen. My list is complete.
Oh, that guy sucks. Oh.
But you know who should be on that list?
Who?
Me. Judas Gray.
You've not wrestled in Aberdeen.
I've not wrestled in Aberdeen yet.
What?
Oh my God. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. Not only is Roman King my bestest bud in the whole world gonna beat up Caelan Valhalla, but I'm gonna come all the way up there just to beat up Conor Malone.
Won't be much of a challenge.
Oh, you know. Roman, you son of a bitch.
So next up is a match I'm very excited for. It's Conor Malloy, who just spoke about, versus Judas Gray. So Judas Gray is making his debut in WrestleZone. This guy is, from what I've seen little bits of matches here and there. He's a very exciting prospect coming up against another very exciting wrestler in Conor Malloy. And yeah, this is going to be like blink and you miss it kind of action. But yeah, what's your take on it?
I think you've nailed it right there, Billy. I think this one is going to be high octane. This one is going to be flying all over the place. Obviously, I've got to try and put a little bit of the homegrown bias to one side. Obviously, I've known Conor for many years now. He came through the training academy as well. Judas Gray, I've met one time. Seemed like a nice enough guy. I had the chance to see him in the ring. A hell of an athlete. An absolute hell of an athlete. You guys at Halloween Hijinks, you guys sitting in the seats, you're in for a treat with this one. Conor's, you know, we've seen what he can do in WrestleZone. He mixes it up with everybody. Has he been in there with someone who is pretty much the mirror image of him? I'm not sure. This could be that night. And this, it's a debut. It's a first appearance. You want to make a great first impression. What better than knocking off a guy who's a former tag team champion and is currently sitting on the chance, a title shot of his choosing? That would be a big statement for young Mr. Gray.
And to put, maybe again, don't want to put pressure on these guys too much, but Conor has clearly got that inspiration from Eddie Guerrero, the Guerrero family, with his in-ring style. And Judas Gray's got that Jeff Hardy risk-taking, chaotic kind of unpredictability as well. So to see that kind of styles match up, like I was saying, this is just high-flying. There's going to be some hijinks possibly as well, because we've seen who Judas Gray's running with young Ronan King.
That does throw a spanner in the works a little bit if you're Conor, I suppose. We'll see if that has anything. I think Mr. King might have his eyes on a bigger prize that night, as I'm sure we're going to get to in a little while. But that could be an interesting take on things if things develop in Conor's favour. Maybe Ronan King looks to stick his oar in, as he's apt to do.
It absolutely is. And I didn't write that many notes about this one because it's just a match that I'm just excited to see. And it's one, when you write it down, there's going to be matches that are going to be show stealers for one reason or another. But this one, for a pure athleticism standpoint and just a pure entertainment value, if these guys start cooking, then we're going to be eating well at Halloween Hijinks. Yes. It's going to be an absolute barn burner. I'm throwing in all the cliches.
From my point of view, that's all right. I'm used to sitting next to James Chester doing commentary. You throw all the cliches at me you like, sir. The from my point of view on that, on commentary, though, I'm dealing with these guys are going to do things I don't even know what to call them. So this is going to be a headache. But you guys are going to love it. I know that. You guys are going to love it. And so will I, just maybe after the fact.
I'll be charging my phone up specifically for this. So when I'm doing the my montage or whatever, I'll be just going through going, oh, that happened. Oh, God, that happened as well. And just going through. So I'm not being able, again.
Link, can you miss it, folks?
When it comes, I'm going to say pressure quite a lot. It seems to be my buzzword for the evening, but I'm no pressure on Adam here, but if he's writing a review of the show, I will be looking at your notes before the review goes out, just to make sure that I don't forget anything. Because I always hate when I put out something.
That's you delegating again, isn't it?
Yeah, got to. I'm the boss. But I hate when I do things like reviews or do the podcast or whatever, and I miss out something really obvious. I'm like, I can't go back on the podcast and just go, oh yeah, I missed this bit. When it's went out for a couple of days.
It'll inset just in the corner, by the way.
Yeah. But if you miss anything, though, you just buy it on DVD. Halloween Hijinks will be out on DVD probably around about Christmas Chaos time. So.
Yeah, you can switch off the audio. You don't need to listen to me. It's all right.
I know. I'll go get the context. I like a little bit of context for my wrestling.
If you're sitting there live on the night, you'll hear me anyway. I get a little bit excited sometimes.
It's always good. Always good. I quite like sometimes I do like to try and get closer to yourself and to Chester just to get that little bit of context. I know there was no way I was going to say that. It didn't sound creepy, but I like to get a little bit within your shot so I can get that experience of getting a little bit of commentary at the same time. It's
I can always shout louder. It's all right. It's fine.
Go for it. So not much more to say about that match. It's going to be an absolute
vocal cords. I need them.
It's just going to be an absolute incredible match. So we'll just move on to something completely different, I think, for the show. So next match.
It seems Damien accepted my challenge for Halloween Hijinks because WrestleZone have made it official. Halloween Hijinks. Captain Alan Sterling versus the revolutionary Damien. But it won't be any ordinary match. Oh, no. They've announced it'll be a Halloween switcheroo match. Which means, for one night only, you lucky people in attendance, and you, Damien, will get to see, for one night only, the revolutionary Alan Sterling. But Damien, don't think that this makes you a captain for one night. You'll never be a captain. I sailed the high seas, I went to captain school, all to become a captain, and you'll never be a captain. But for one night only, as well as it being all about Alan, I shall be the revolution. As Halloween Hijinks approaches ever closer, Alan, I don't know if you've had a hand in this, but suddenly our match is a Halloween switcheroo match. It sounds like a kind of thing that you'd have your hand in. You know what? After the last 12 months that I've had, screw it. Let's have a bit of fun. Batten down the hatches! Because dead ahead, on the 21st of October, Alan, Captain, you find out firsthand that I'm a better captain than you will ever be. Yar.
So next up, it's the Halloween switcheroo, which I'm going to be perfectly honest. I dropped the ball here with my initial notes because I didn't write down it was a Halloween switcheroo. So I was just going through it, going, okay, this match is going to be interesting because you've got Captain Alan on one side and you've got Damien on the other, and then just going through the promo videos, which people will have seen by now if they're watching and listening to this. It dawned on me going, oh. There's something different going on with this because it's a Halloween switcheroo. It's a switcheroo, which we've seen some Halloween switcheroos in the past. Have you been in one of the switcheroos? I don't think you have.
Thankfully not.
No, you're not.
Wearing this is enough. I don't want to wear anyone else's gear. Come on now.
No, you don't want to go against Mr. P and get a bald cap on top of that. No, just...
I mean, I teamed with him once and wore the kilt. Is that not enough? That's fine, isn't it?
That's fine. So we've got Damien versus Captain Alan Sterling, Halloween switcheroo. So for those that are unaware, it means that the wrestlers dress as the other in the match, and that's about it. That's kind of the rules for the match.
You should see the state of it before the show, having to send someone to each area of a dressing room to bring each other's gear to the other. That's always an assignment I'm glad I don't have.
So last year, if I remember rightly, it was last year. God, the time has gone past so quickly. It was Mr. P and Sean Johnson against the Foundation of the Future in a switcheroo match,
indeed.
Which was very interesting because Mr. P and Sean Johnson, they were having a whale of a time. The Foundation, not so much, but they came out with the win. So, you know, cancels it out, I think, quite nicely.
I think it added a bit of fuel to the fire for the Foundation lads that night. I don't think they appreciated the giggles flying in their direction for various reasons, and they took it out on their opponents that night and came away still tag team champions. So maybe it worked in their favour.
The interesting thing with this, Captain Alan Sterling, we've seen him wrestle. He is a very talented wrestler, but also a buffoon.
Definitely interesting. That's one word you can use, yes.
Yeah, a buffoon is another word as well. But he's got a pretty good.
he said that, not me.
He's got a pretty good win loss record. In the last year, 2 years or so, he's you can't underestimate Captain Alan Sterling.
Yes, he does.
But you come in with Damien, who isn't really known for his happy-go-lucky, fun side so much. He's more of a. He's come to wrestle.
You can call him a moody git. It's all right.
I know, but the two of them, Damien scares me more than Captain Alan. I don't know if it's the eye patch that does it. That's scaring me more at the moment. But yeah, it's and plus he keeps ghosting me for interviews. So Damien is yeah, scares me a little bit. But so Damien's going to be coming out with the sailor suit. Will he have a t-shirt with all Damien faces on it? So it'll be all about Damien.
Ooh, that'd be interesting, wouldn't it?
You should sell that on the merch stand. And Captain Alan will have the I don't know which singlet he will choose. I'm sure he'll want to pick which one.
Our revolutionary's had many different looks across his career, so who knows where we're going to go when it comes to Captain Alan Sterling, who himself is not shy of a wardrobe change or two.
No, but he is shy at ironing if he's going to pass over his sailor outfit.
Would you trust that man with household appliances?
That's very true. You know what? You filled in the blanks for me there when talking
think
about
deeper, his... Think deeper, you'll get there.
But these two have history as well, of course, both being part of Sterling Oil.
Very much.
A team that you've had many run-ins with and along with.
Ooh, more than enough.
With Will, of course, William being your former tag team partner as Thunder Buddies. So you've you've had your fair share of Sterling Oil history. From a viewing standpoint as a wrestler, but Damien and Captain Alan, this is again, like I said, something completely different because of the stipulation. Will Alan throw out some Damien offense? Will Damien go all mixed martial Damien and throw that in there? It's just there's so many possibilities around this. Endless.
This is what I mean. Is you've got two guys here who are WrestleZone since day one. True originals, 15 years behind them. Two of the most decorated guys in company history, and they've achieved it different ways, but two of the best. Who knows what we're going to see here? Does Damien really want this going on? The mind of Captain Alan is a strange and vivid place. Who knows what we're going to see from him? Damien could mix it up with anyone. We've seen that. But he needs to, I think, keep it in check a little bit because this might be a test like no other.
I mean, he said himself, his last year has been a bit of a, not a great one, losing the title at Christmas Chaos.
I believe the phrase snake bit comes into it.
A little bit, yeah. Of course, he got stabbed by Ronan King, which I feel like it's still nobody's really talking about the fact that he got stabbed in the eye.
I would like to just forget it happened, to be honest with you.
And then he unfortunately had his injury at Christmas Chaos. He got injured at Aberdeen Anarchy as well. So I suppose Captain Alan, as an opponent, it's probably more mind games than possibly a physical altercation with Cap Nalan. So maybe it's just because Damien's not going to have a great time, possibly, but it probably is going to be the most rest his body's had in a match in quite a number of months as well.
Well, possibly. I mean, I think, you know, to get the lighthearted aspect out of the way first, I think Damien's just happy that this match isn't happening in Dangston because he tends to lose body parts when he goes there. But the you're right, more of a mental game when it's coming. And we've all seen it happen. We know he can do it. One of the heaviest hitters on the roster. Damien knows that. He's crossed paths with him before. They've been partners. They've been opponents. Damien won't take him lightly, but it depends what kind of mind frame that Alan's in, I think, because you never know. You never really know. We don't really see him on the day either. It's match time. He's here and he comes out and he's dressed maybe not to the nines, but maybe to the threes. And he goes in and still, like you say, he gains his fair share of wins. He gains his fair share of championship glory when he puts his mind to it. The only thing he's not done is being undisputed champion. He goes in there and beats Damien. That puts him right in line for a championship match, in my opinion. That would be a step. That would be a step. I don't know what you think of that one.
Well, I remember when Aspen returned at Summerhill Showdown. Of course, I remember that. I was off my seat and crying.
We're not even talking about him yet, and he's talking about him.
I found my ways. But one of the things he said in his time on the microphone afterwards, after he fended off the Foundation of the Future, was one of the things he wanted to accomplish, along with winning the Regal Rumble, winning the Undisputed title, was facing Alan Starling.
Check.
So if Alan beats Damien, like you're saying, then surely if Aspen, of course, wins his match, which we'll talk about, that, you're right, that possibly puts him in line, whether it happens at Stonehaven or even at Christmas Chaos, that surely puts Alan, not to dismiss Damien, I suppose whoever wins in this match probably has that.
Damien wants to get back in that picture as well, absolutely.
Yeah, so, and
one more to be a 5-time champion, of course he does.
And if Christmas Chaos happens at Dangston, maybe some redemption as well if he's able to get past.
He might call him sick that night, I don't know.
Quite possibly, and who would blame him after the last two appearances haven't really went his way. But yeah, so that's an hour for me as a match. This is just, I know people go on about me just actually bang on about WrestleZone, but when you look at a card like this, and you know the characters, and you know the stories, you know the wrestlers, the personalities, this is just an absolute colossal card once again for WrestleZone. So when I can move into that, well, it's well deserved. You've always treated me well as a viewer.
They get me off the cards, folks, and it improves no end. I told them for years it was going to happen.
Hey, I was there at Trinity Centre. I was there when you got in the ring at Trinity Centre. So
don't again. I got gubbed in quick succession. So we'll move on swiftly, I think.
Yeah, don't mention that. Anyway, right. Next up, we're going to talk about the big one, the 6-man tag. So
here we go.
So there's been no promo videos as yet, so this is going to be very embarrassing for me when I start editing and a video goes out tonight or tomorrow morning before I finish the edit.
There will be something, I'm sure.
But if not, keep an eye on WrestleZone's social media pages, and you're sure you'll find out. There'll be
6 guys here that you can't shut up at the best of times. They're going to have something to say, I think.
Absolutely. So I'll do the little pause so we can do the graphic. And there we are. The outfit, Ted O'Keefe, Murphy, Dino, taking on the Foundation of the Future, Zach Dynamite, Ryan Riley, and Bruiser Brad Evans. And for my money, when Mr. Patterson, he's now, because he's in management, he gets his full surname again. When it was announced that there was going to be a second Halloween brawl, I was going to put money that this would be the match that had it. But I was wrong, so thankfully I did not.
I'm not sure we need to give these guys weaponry.
That's the thing. That's the other thing.
I think we're all right anyway here.
I mean, from a standpoint as someone who's well tuned with the trainees and with the Wrestling Training Academy, as extra trainees been invited along, being told that we might need some extra security for this match, because this one is going to be chaotic. That's just the long and short of it.
That's a tricky one, because the answer would be, yes, we require all hands on deck because we saw what happened in Inverurie, and this is an even bigger occasion. Mm-hmm. If I was to tell any academy students that, they'd probably run a mile.
That's true.
So, oh, that's a tricky one. We might have to play that by ear in the next couple of days. But yes, batten down the hatches, riot shields at the ready. This one is going to go everywhere.
So this really kicked off a battle of the nations. We had the Foundation of the Future. At the time, it was Ryan Riley and Bruiser Brad that were in the ring, calling out or running down all the tag teams in WrestleZone. And then Lightfoot being one of them, they didn't take too kindly to it. And that's pretty much where we're at. Inverurie was, it ended up being a stalemate. One win, one loss, one draw for both teams involved. If that was just a preview of what we're going to expect, then that's going to be a long night for you guys. I'm going to love it.
Inverurie missed the Andre preview right there. That was just a taster, and it descended into chaos. And here we go. We're putting all six of them in the ring and just saying, "Have at it, fellas."
So the interesting thing is, his last time there was a match, kind of on, maybe not on the scale, but it was Dino and Ted O'Keefe against Omar Muhammad and the retired Scotty Swift, which was Summer Hill Showdown, wasn't it? It was chaos at that time, and there was only four of them there, and we didn't have Murphy at that point in the Foundation. In the outfit, the Foundation weren't even involved, and they know how to cause some chaos at the same time. Again, is this one of those matches where we talked about possibly trying to drag as many people, all hands on deck, to try and control the environment? But is this one of those where you kind of look over to the merch stand and go, let's maybe just close the door to that room. Let's just keep that
possibly,
separate.
Yeah.
Maybe lock a door or two.
Good. There's no big windows in the hall we're going to be in, that type of thing. Let's keep them in the ring as much as we can. This time I have to fight the temptation to jump in and separate people because I'll be plugged in. I'll be commentating.
Mm-hmm.
So you're on your own, staff guys. I'm sorry.
You'll be there when it all kicks off. You'll just be sitting there going, oh no, oh no, guys. You just, I mean, last time the
put that boy down. Stop throwing him.
Leave Evan alone.
Evan.
Oh, Evan, yeah. It was a beautiful shot of him trying to hold back Bruiser Brad. God love you, Evan Young.
Good on him for trying.
You try that.
Bigger men would not have tried.
Absolutely. I was 3 meters away, and I was like, I'm not.
I just want it out there. I had my hands full at the time. I was holding back a very angry Ryan Riley.
It is noted. Speaking of Ryan Riley, the segues, this dynamic we've got going on. He has put in a question about this particular match, directed to yourself as well. So I'll read it out verbatim because I love Ryan Riley's tweets. They're lovely. Hi, Billy. Hope you're well. Could you please ask Mr. Thunder? He's very polite. And then the bell rings. I don't know what happens. Could you please ask Mr. Thunder his thoughts on the sheer audacity of the outfit thinking they can go toe-to-toe with the Foundation? They've been a trio for 10 minutes. Laughing emoji.
Oh, well, that's a shot across the bow, isn't it? Has he got a point? In his mind, yes, because obviously the Foundation have been a trio a lot longer. They've had, well, going back to, what, 2019 now, I think?
I think it was the Regal Rumble that year. Yeah, I think that's when they formed.
There we go. So they've had a few years of honing their skills, and not just in WrestleZone now. They're spreading their wings. They've been other places. They're racking up other opponents, other audiences, great for them. The outfit, this is only the second time we're going to see them as a three-piece in a six-man tag team match. Does that work in the favour of the Foundation? I think so. And I think that's what Mr. Riley is alluding to there. Plus, he's also getting a little bit of a dig in. That's his style, as we well know it. The outfit maybe aren't as refined as a in-the-ring team, but how close are they away from the ring? How tight-knit are they as an actual group? They keep that to themselves. The Foundation are maybe a little bit more public about things, a little bit more out there for everyone to see. The outfit could definitely spring a surprise. After all, You go back to Battle of the Nations. Only back in August, did you see them picking a fight with the Foundation of the Future, 3-on-3, and then going as far as to maybe have a big say in the outcome of the Tri-County Championship that night? I didn't. I didn't see that coming. I don't think a lot of people did. I don't think when they arrived at the building that night that the outfit knew that. Ryan Riley, Brad Evans and Toe chose to run their mouths, and this is what we end up with. An absolute six-man tag team war. Now, I'm the biggest fan of tag team wrestling there is. I love it to death. You come to the training academy and you're in one of my sessions, I'm going to bore you to death with tag team wrestling stuff. That's just what I'm going to do. Usually, I would see this match on paper and I'd sit there and say, oh, this is one I'm looking forward to. This is going to be a belter. Two of the best teams in the country, just let them go at it. This isn't going to be a tag team wrestling match. No. This isn't going to be a tag team wrestling match. They're going to batter each other. All six of them. Like I say, Inverurie was just a little taster. Dino sparked out Brad Evans. When's that ever happened before? He's had his way with people, and Dino sparked him out with that elbow of his. Unbelievable. Ryan Riley body slammed Big Murphy. And Ted O'Keefe went toe-to-toe with one of the very best in the country in Zach Dynamite. And I don't think Zach Dynamite was prepared for that. I don't think the Foundation of the Future was prepared for that. And we better be prepared for it at Halloween Hijinks. Otherwise, who knows what's going to go on.
Don't think I could put it any better way. It's one of those matches. It's going to be it's going to be a brawl, in Halloween brawl in all but name. But this is going to be an absolute... If you're front row,
this is the brawl at Halloween Hijinks, not the Halloween brawl.
There we go. That's one for the commentary.
Hold on, I'm writing that down. I'm going to say that instead.
I'll be watching DVD, waiting for it. But no, will anything be settled tonight on Saturday? I don't think so. I think this is going to just be another chapter in this war. This feud. It's going to be a battle in this war.
I would say so because. It's like we saw last time out. Somebody's going to win, somebody's going to lose, or it's going to be a stalemate. Now, we had a little bit of everything last time. This one can only go one of three ways. If it's a win for the Foundation, do you think the outfit are going to be all right with that? I don't. If it's a win for the outfit, the Foundation, they've shown in previous times, they don't like to have a loss sitting that's left unanswered. They come back for more. And if it's a stalemate, you can't leave it there. You can't leave it there. You've got to come back and do something else. I don't know what's going to happen. We're going to wait and see. There's going to be bruises. There's going to be too much going on. This might be the only time we get to see it as a 3-on-3 because there could be some injuries coming out of this one.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. That's probably one of the more on the serious side of matches on this show, and the match that you thought I was going to allude to for something completely different, we're going to go for something completely different next, in the first of two Halloween Brawl matches. So let's get into it. There's a 4-minute video that's coming up with a Zoom call, which I think maybe more or less sense of what we're doing just now, but it's going to play, and I will be back in a minute.
Enjoy, everyone.
No one here. Where is he?
Ryan, is that you?
Yes, come on.
In you come.
What are you doing in there?
It's our hideout.
Get out here.
What do you mean? People might hear.
There's no one here, Brian.
Are you sure?
100% sure.
Okay, let's be quick. You wanted to talk.
Halloween Brawl, Omar Mohammed and Mr. WrestleZone.
I'm not really happy about this.
No, me neither. I thought we'd have the switcheroo.
Yeah, hey, I'm down for the switcheroo.
Because then you'd have the mask. You'd have to take the mask off to be one of us.
Then, indisputable proof who Mr. WrestleZone is.
Ha! Huh, typical. We've been dealt the hand we've been dealt, so we need to come up with some kind of plan in order to beat Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed once and for all.
You want a plan, right? Let me put my thinking cap on. Okay. Thinking cap on, right. Halloween. Witches. Ghouls.
No. Witches and ghosts are in Shakespeare. I am terrified of ghosts.
Zombies.
Yeah, I like zombies. Do you like zombies?
Nah, I don't like zombies. No. Think. I've got it. Bats.
I like bats. Do you like bats?
I like bats too.
Excellent. We have our theme.
A theme for what though, Reese? I don't follow.
We need to get in their heads. Uh-huh. Mr. WrestleZone likes to dress up, so we're gonna dress up.
Great idea. I think we're on the same page.
Page. That's very good. They're gonna see that our bite is just as bad as our bark.
You know what, Reese Dawkins? Yeah. It's going to be a dark night for Omar Muhammad and Mr. WrestleZone.
That's excellent.
Wait, they're coming.
Go.
It's landing. Yeah, let's go. Close the door.
Wonders of technology,
Mr. WrestleZone. You got Zoom working.
I got the Moon Zoom, the most complicated of all the Zooms, and I've done it a crack. I've done it, but now it's the spookiest season in the history of seasons and spooks. Because what's going on? There's pumpkins and there's skeletons and there's floating aliens.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
I think you've got the point of the Halloween hijinks thing a bit confused. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
What's that in the background? Because that's been twice that's appeared there. What's that Shirvani doing there?
Move past it.
I'm not going to move past it. I want to know, what's that doing there?
Let's talk about Halloween hijinks. Let's talk about a Halloween brawl. Let's talk about a match that's so scary that the only way to win is to scare your opponent so much that they go to the referee and they say, that's me quitting and I've had enough.
No, Mr. Wrestler.
What?
Did you not read the terms and conditions of the contract? I sent it to you.
I thought that was a spam email.
Why would you? I had my email address.
Oh, right. You're good. You're good. Okay. So what you mean to tell me that I've been researching horror films for the past fortnight. I've got my horror t-shirt on and I've wasted my time. I'm renaming this match to Halloween 3, Season of the Witch.
No, you're not.
Yeah.
It's called a Halloween brawl. I tried to get it changed to a Halloween brawl, but they didn't allow that. Okay.
Oh.
So I'm very much annoyed, and I guess you're annoyed. But you know who's not gonna be annoyed?
Who?
The fans.
Who?
Because you want to know the rules. You want to know the rules of a Halloween brawl?
Yes.
No disqualification. No countouts. Weapons vast and many, as long as they're Halloween themed. And I've got an idea. I've got an idea for a weapon.
Tell me what it is. Tell me what it is. I'm so close right now. I'm so close right now.
I can't tell you because there might be someone watching in this tiny little screen over here. Like, right there.
Well, I've got a surprise for you. I have the most powerful arse in the history of anything involving a ring. Even boxing. Anything with a ring.
We know that.
But I've got a secret weapon for Halloween. And my backside will have the power of a season contained.
Wait, the weapon's in your backside?
Yes. Because when we get the Halloween hijinks at Curl Aberdeen, October 21st, when I'm not going to talk about the fact that I'm a world championship caliber curling participant, I'm not going to talk about it because I'm really modest. When we get there, Mr. Tucker and Mr. Dawkins, they're going to be saying,
oh, God, the heat be Jay. This is the worst Halloween ever. I'm so spooked.
Roll it! Roll. That's a wrap, boys.
No, roll what?
Get the tea on. We're done.
This isn't a movie. It's
Mrs. Donut's going to have a crumpet from you. What?
It's a. Do you want to do the thing?
Our life belongs on the silver screen. In the final chapter of our story, will be told when we get those two Wallies and we teach them a lesson that they'll never forget unless their memory is really good. Then they might remember.
You are an absolute pain. Goodbye.
Use your thingy. We're making films.
We're working.
And we're back. It's the Halloween brawl. It's Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad taking on and I keep getting this wrong, so I'm going to make sure I've written it down. Warriors against low-life entities. Brian Tucker and Reese Dawkins.
Yes.
Halloween brawl.
Oh dear.
And I don't think Mr. WrestleZone knows what Halloween brawl is. So we've got that. It's been about a year.
Steep learning curve ahead, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, it's been about a year since Omar really engaged with Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, and Mr. WrestleZone, of course, made his debut in the Regal Rumble. That's when we first saw the Mr. WrestleZone. We don't know who it is. Clearly, we've already confirmed it's definitely not Scottie Swift. Scottie Swift was at home the night of Regal Rumble, so it can't be him. We know it's not Jonathan Geddes.
Definitely smell like Scottie Swift. I know that much.
We know it's not Jonathan Geddes because we saw him in the same room at Harvey the Anarchy. So there's his mention for the episode, which you'll obviously request in the comments. So there's a mystery there. And, I mean, you've had your fair share of mystery in the past, of course, being also a mask competitor.
Definitely not me. I know that much.
As a fellow mask competitor, though, do you have some sympathy for Mr. WrestleZone trying to keep his identity a secret? Or do you think he even is aware that he's wearing a mask a lot of the time?
Oh, good question. Second part first. No, I don't think he does. First part, second, tricky. Like you've spoken in the past about my perceived reluctance to be on here with yourself, and that's purely because I don't want to be sitting wearing this thing all the time. Mr. WrestleZone, from what I can gather, is in full regalia all the time, and that's Omar's problem, not mine, and I'm happy about that. This one is very much on Omar's shoulders because he's not only got to lead Mr. WrestleZone through this particular battle, but he's also got to make him aware of the scenario, the rules, etc., etc., etc. Good luck, mate.
Yeah, I mean, how Omar has the patience of an absolute saint. Because
he's a good kid, but sometimes it's just come on, because you can just stand up for yourself. Come on, it's all right. You don't need to take this fella under your wing. It's all right.
He's an interesting cat, is Mr. WrestleZone, and yeah, I mean, we saw in the match graphic he's got a Santa hat on, and I think that's just going to be the omen for this particular bout. Is who knows, what is he going to turn up in a costume? Is Mr. WrestleZone going to? I mean, we saw Battle of Nations, which is possibly my favorite moment, one of my favorite moments of the evening, where he wore a mask on top of his own mask, which it elated me in a way that I didn't think it would until it happened. I was rising from my seat. What can we say more about this match? Because there's nothing seems to be settled. We've got Tucker and Dawkins who are obsessed about finding out about Mr. WrestleZone. Mr. WrestleZone, who's probably finding out many things on his time on Earth or wherever he is residing. And then Omar's just there in the middle. Just, I think at this point, it started as a feud, a rivalry. I think even Omar's fed up of the Warriors against the whole life
entities. Seems that way, doesn't it? Yeah.
So I don't know how this ends. So I don't know. Like, talking about the foundation of future of the outfit, like what will it take for one team to give up or move on?
I think it comes back to the fact that Mr. Tucker would very much like to ascertain the identity of one Mr. WrestleZone. Sadly, yeah. For Rhys Dawkins, he seems to have become a little warped along the lines of Brian Tucker along the way. Poor Omar's had to shoulder all of this for everyone. That's a poor guy. And Mr. WrestleZone is seemingly just happy to be outside at times. So,
yeah,
have to think that Tucker and Dawkins are going to force the issue. Mm-hmm. We saw the multiple masks, like you're pointing out. Who knows? Maybe there is a costume in the offing for Mr. WZ, and maybe Tucker and Dawkins can find a way in that way, because all I know is that I would like this internal investigation of theirs just to end. I'm fed up being at the training academy and them come swanning in and disrupting things, asking people questions and just subjecting them to various tests and whatever. It's getting out of hand, guys. Just leave it alone. Please.
Do you want to throw in any predictions on who it could be?
Predictions on who it could be. I think it's someone who knows Omar Muhammad. I think a little bit more than he's letting on.
Possibly.
But let's not spoil it. Let's let everyone have their own opinions on it, because that's more of the fun.
Absolutely. It definitely cannot be Sean Johnson, who hasn't been seen since Christmas. Could be. House. So could be. Yeah, could be that.
He's not here.
Exactly. We saw Mr. P come back, who is actually on my short list of possibilities, but again, they've been in the same room. We've seen
not
them.
Not him.
But
we said earlier we did see Mr. P and Sean dressing up last year, so we know that Sean's not a stranger to a costume.
Yeah, that's it. Or could be.
Yeah, get that one on your bit of nods, people.
There you go. We do have a couple of questions from the wrestlers involved in this match, so we'll get into them. We've got Omar, Mr. Omar Muhammad. He's got it's less of a question, it's more of a statement. He's put, tell Blue Thunder I miss him. I miss his Wednesday rants. Also, there's no Rowies in Fife. Help.
Yeah, that's true. I can sympathise with both of those things. Sorry, Omar.
So I don't
You're
know.
You're not missing too much Wednesday rants, though. I'll easily just send them to him.
I don't know if that's just him really just asking, can you get some Rowies on Saturday?
I think so, but that's the good thing about Curl Aberdeen. There's a massive Tesco next door. We can just run across. You'll be fine.
It is. When I first saw the Curl, I went to Curl for the first event there, and I saw the big Tesco. I was like, ace. That means I can get a load up on Krispy Kreme donuts and Dr. Pepper or two before I go home. That's just the... I love a venue that's got a massive supermarket next to it. I like Dainston. Dainston's got the Tesco along the road as well. It's ace.
It's always a bonus for the boys as well, believe you me. But if you are nipping in for some baked goods there, Omar, please, no sugar for Mr. WrestleZone. I think he's had enough.
Absolutely. So I think that's, again, so much. We've talked about this match or this combination of tag teams for long enough. Well, I have anyway on podcasts and writing, what have you. So I don't think there's anything more we can say about this particular match other than it's not going to be like the main event Halloween Brawl. This will be a little bit possibly more the treat side of trick or treats.
Ooh, I like what you did there. He's tying it all together. It's seasonal. The only thing I'd like to see is Reese Dawkins to get a good slap in, but that's just personal. That's all right.
Oh, that's the other question I've got. Reese Dawkins. Who is the most improved WrestleZone talent of 2023 and why is it him?
Well, it's not because he's allowed himself to get sort of whooped in the brain by Mr. Brian Tucker. So, no, that's a backward step from what I've been seeing. Most improved talent of the year, based on recent performances, Murphy?
Can't argue with that. No, absolutely.
Based on making a splash since he's been back, Mr. O'Keefe?
Yeah.
Ollie and Tommy continue to improve, like we were saying earlier with our bonus match for Hijinks. I don't think there's anyone who's really taken a step backwards except Mr. Dawkins. So, pretty much level playing field there, maybe.
I mean, and it's just except the attempted manslaughter, Ronan as well has had a pretty solid year, even though he's end up in blindfold matches by his own doing.
That's very true. That young man's trajectory since he debuted has very much been an upward steep spike. It's not even a curve. He continues to impress.
He's tremendous.
So, yeah, I mean, answers on a postcard, viewers. You let us know. Who do you think is the most improved WrestleZone wrestler of 2023? P.S. It's not Reese Dawkins. It's not me either. So there you go. It's fair, isn't it?
And while you're doing that, while you're writing that, we're going to go into the penultimate match. So again, there'll be some videos up next. And then we'll speak about the Tri-Counties Championship match between Caleb Valhalla and Ronan King, who we just mentioned.
Here we go.
Good job, buddy. Nice tower defense, huh? You look really good with it. It's just, at Halloween, I'm going to look so much better when it's around my waist instead of yours.
You're just going to get in my business.
I'm
going to
kick
time, right?
Your head in at Halloween. Believe me,
I'd love to see
you. You'd love that, huh? How's this feel, huh? I'm going to kill you, Cal! Yeah. I'm going to kill you! Hey, come on, get off me! Get off me! I'm going to kill you! You ain't trying to kill me no more, boy!
Well, we'll turn it on an 80 or something.
Valhalla, the epitome of a dumbass. See, Caleb, for our match coming up, I've done some extensive research. I played God of War. I played God of War Ragnarok. I played Assassin's Creed Valhalla. I sat through 8 goddamn hours of Thor movies just to try and get a feel of what you'll be thinking in that ring. And what I've discovered is you can be thinking about very little. You're a simple-minded creature, Caleb. You only want to destroy. You don't have the strategy like Ronan King. And that's gonna be your downfall, because Ronan King's strategy is the best in Scottish wrestling. Caleb, how easily have I got in your head? For example, after the Inverurie show, when I squared up to you backstage, your first thought was to hit, hit, hit. It doesn't matter how many times you hit me. Caleb, I've been hit by almost every man in this country. Ronan King has taken more hits than anyone, and Ronan King gets better and stronger every time. And Ronan King always comes out on top, because Ronan King's strategy is immaculate. And you're gonna find that out on October 21st. You see, Caleb, every god has their weakness. Every Superman has their kryptonite. Every Caleb Valhalla has their Ronan King.
Ronan King, you want to play games? Well, the mighty Caleb's favorite game is rip the head off the pretty boy. You want to get inside the mighty Caleb's head? Well, the mighty Caleb wants to take your head home as a trophy. The mighty Caleb's head is a dark place to be. You said it yourself, there's not much strategy. No, there is one strategy, and that is smash and destroy anything in the mighty Caleb's path. And it's done the mighty Caleb pretty well so far. You decided to take an opportunity. You want to approach the mighty Caleb after he won the Tri-Counties Championship at Battle of the Nations. Well done, the mighty Caleb respects that. But you made a fatal mistake when you came to the mighty Caleb after Inverurie. When you tried to attack the mighty Caleb, you didn't get the job done. Well, now you'll get to see the mighty Caleb's great strategy, up close and personal. There's not a free seat at Halloween Hijinks. Everyone wants to see the mighty Caleb teach Ronan King some respect. Skull! Skull! Skull!
And we're back. So, well, we didn't leave, but you guys saw some videos. I know, it was very awkward. I've been here for an hour waiting. Tri-Counties Championship match. Caleb Valhalla, the champion, defending against Ronan King. This is a match set just minutes after Caleb won the title back at Battle of the Nations, with Ronan confronting him just after the match, straight away. And as soon as that video went out on the social medias, I was very excited for this, because two guys, Caleb, I've made no secrets about Caleb being one of my favorite wrestlers right now. And Ronan, another one who, despite him being the absolute worst in being a menace to society and to everything involved with wrestling, with his either swearing on shows or his errant attacks and, I don't know, stabbing.
I'm not going to take off the language wise, you're all right.
But he's a phenomenal wrestler. As well, and it's ridiculous. He shouldn't be 19 years old. No,
that's the thing. He's still a teenager. The talented little so and so. That is unbelievable. And I met him when he joined our youth classes at the training academy. So you know he was under 16. And the growth in that kid is, he won't like me calling him that, but I don't care. The growth in him is unbelievable, and now. He's He's getting himself out all across the country. He's turning heads wherever he goes. He's making people sit up and take notice. And that is to his credit. Is it his time for a championship match? You'd probably say that. Is it his time to become a champion? We're going to find that out.
That's the thing. We'll go back. We're talking about throwing some logic win-loss kind of thing here. He hasn't got the best win-loss record in WrestleZone, but...
He doesn't let it phase him, though, does he?
He doesn't, but he always comes out with one of the most talked about moments on the show. He lost to Grado at last year's Halloween Hijinks, but everyone was talking about that match because it was incredible.
It was the wings, right? It was the wings.
It was the wings, the 450 over the top ropes, landing on his feet. Just
how did he not break his ankles?
I broke my ankles watching it.
And I
had a ring post in the way as well, and I still saw. It's also enough for me to for my bones to creak. And again, you're going in a match with going back a year into a match with Grado, and that's for 19, well, we've been probably 18 at that point. For an 18-year-old, that's a big, big match to have. And it, like you said, it doesn't faze him. Nothing seems to faze him.
No.
Even things like the blindfold match, even things like that, he's so confident in himself that he believes he's the greatest, that it translates into anything he does. And even dragged Captain Alan Sterling around in Inverurie as well, when Captain was probably on the more silly side of the coin that particular night. And he's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's like you said, when he issued the challenge to Caleb. Caleb had just gotten back through to the dressing area, hadn't even sat down, hadn't still had the belt, his newly won title belt in his hand, and Ronan King's in his face challenging him to be his first contender at a major event. That's coming off the back of losing that blindfold match. So that shows you just the cojones that this young kid possesses. Can you call him full of himself? Yes. Can you call him conceited? Can you call him arrogant? You can call him all of those things. I'm going to call him a bloody good wrestler. I'm going to call him someone who's got 20 years ahead of him to be one of the best in the world, to be as good as he wants to be. Is this his first major win? I know a very, very, very angry Viking who might not see it that way.
Yeah. I mean, Caleb had a amazing start. Had a bit of a strange 2022.
That's the one.
Trying to get a hold of Alan Sterling, who's getting a lot of mentions tonight. He'll be sailing on all these comments.
He's never far away.
And he had a bit of a strange 2022, and then coming into 2023, won the Regal Rumble. He lost to Lost Boy Aspen at Avery Anarchy, but you know that was it, who really came out a loser in that match, because both of them were absolutely battered and broken and all that kind of stuff. Absolutely. And then bouncing back at Battle of Nations, winning the Tri-Counties Championship, then retaining it against Vago and Brian Tucker in Vruri. You can't imagine Caleb letting go of that title without a lot of fight and a lot of... it's not going to be easy for Ronan King, as much as he probably thinks it may be, but it's not going to be easy.
It's like you're saying about the captain there. He did everything he could to not be in a fight against Caleb Valhalla. Ronan King's gone up and picked a fight against Caleb Valhalla. Now, I get that there's a title on the line, but still, that takes some nuts. Caleb Valhalla's going to throw that young kid around and enjoy doing it, because that's what he likes to do. He likes to club people. He likes to throw them around. And if the spoils of victory come his way, brilliant. That just means more drinking time afterwards. Now he's got a championship on the line in a one-on-one encounter. That changes the ballgame a little bit for Caleb Valhalla, I think.
Absolutely. And we mentioned in round about the start of the episode, Judas Grey Factor. He's very friendly with Ronan King. Will Caleb, I mean, don't want to put a black mark on how he won the title, but he didn't win it alone. He was assisted, because there was other forces going on outside the ring with the Foundation of the Future, but he didn't win the title on all by himself. There was a little bit of distraction, chaos in the melee and all that.
Ignore that. It's very true.
So he has to know that's a possibility. If we've seen Ronan and Judas be pally-pally, we've seen them be a little bit of friends and already showing their hand a little bit here. Got to watch out for Judas. And it's a guy that Caleb will know about as well, from wrestling in Edinburgh and what have you. So it's very interesting. I mean, Caleb's very fun-loving. He's learning things like light switches and skateboarding and all these cool things of Midgard. But I think maybe Ronan's taken the naivety to being a weakness, possibly, and maybe not. Showing his hand and showing that Judas is there and Judas is a close ally to his. It's gonna be.
Seen of Judas, he's one to throw his body first, think about the consequences second. Maybe when you're taking on the mighty Caleb, that's a good way to be. Because if you think about it for too long, no, thank you. If you're just going in there, the benefit of youthful exuberance, I suppose, you're just going head on. We could say, would it be an upset? I went to say it would be an upset if Ronan King wins the championship. Would it be?
Yeah, that's the question mark on this match. It's one of those where I suppose my heart and head's working different wavelengths, because in my heart, Caleb's my guy. He's the big Viking. He's amazing. I've enjoyed ever since he debuted. I've always had a soft spot for Caleb. But Ronan, and as talented as he is, and how his trajectory has spiked, I wouldn't be against him having a title. My heart's breaking that it would be the expense of Caleb, but at the same time, get that boy a belt. Same thing.
He's got his chance. Up to him to make the most of it.
We do have a question from Ronan, and then we'll move into the main event. He's just asked, how good is Ronan King going to look with the Tri-Counties Championship around his waist?
I would say very good, because that young man tends to look good, dress sense aside, in a lot of different ways. I don't think you can't say that Ronan King has ever come out and wrestled a bad match. He's always come out and it's just been like, that kid's going to go places. Yep. He's got something. Like you said, even in defeat to the likes of Grado, who's world-traveled, experienced, whatever, Ronan King held his own. This is his big chance. Probably the first of many over his career. I wouldn't be surprised if we had a new Tri-Counties champion. I know you didn't want predictions, but I might just go out on a limb here and say, I think we might see a changing of the guard here.
Well, my head's going to be in my hands and my heart's going to be in my stomach, that's for sure. But that's yeah. Again, like I'm talking about, this card is just absolutely stacked to the gunnels for just everything. So let's move on to the main event, the big one, the rematch. It's Lost by Aspen and Vago. Lots of videos coming up, so enjoy them.
Mickey Vago, Battle of the Nations, I beat you, I pinned you, the referee counted 1, 2, 3, I was halfway out the building, and a rematch was made. I didn't even get time to think about it, and a rematch was made. But now that I have thought it over, I've gone from originally not being too happy about this, to thinking, I haven't wrestled up and down this country, breaking my body in various match types to come up against WrestleZone's hardcore guy and this just be a normal match. So I spoke to Mr. Patterson. I spoke to WrestleZone management and they have agreed that Mickey Vago versus Lost Boy Aspen for the WrestleZone Undisputed Championship at Halloween Hijinks is going to be a Halloween brawl.
Back at Battle of the Nations, Lost by Aspen and myself, we had quite the crazy, crazy night. Just a couple of war machines going back and forth, a couple of destroyers throwing bombs at one another, pushing each other to the limit. Aspen, he wanted the best, and he got the best. Now, although the record books will show that Aspen walked away the winner that night, everyone who was in attendance that night knows that really isn't the case. And whether he wants to admit it or not, deep down inside, Aspen knows he didn't beat me that night. You see, after kicking out of two pile drivers, I still had the wherewithal to get my foot in the ropes after he delivered that third. Which is why, after that bell rang at the end of the match, Aspen grabbed his belt and tried to get out of that venue as quickly as he could. Because he was scared. Scared because he saw there was still fight left in me. I was still alive. And he had no idea what it was going to take to keep me down. Now, give him his due. When I got up and challenged him to rematch for that belt, he was man enough to accept. And he's since gone to WrestleZone management and asked for it to be made a Halloween brawl. Now, I'm more than aware of how adept Aspen is at these types of matches. He's been up and down the country in these types of matches, breaking his body. But I have spent the last 3 years here in WrestleZone making a name for myself as the hardcore guy. So Halloween Hijinks, we're going to have ourselves one more unholy battle. The creatures of the night are going to come out to play. And Aspen, while you may be nuts, there is a demon inside me. And maybe at Halloween Hijinks, I let that demon out. Maybe I become that demon. And maybe it's time you kiss that WrestleZone Undisputed title goodbye.
Mickey Vago, I respect the fact that you have toiled away here in WrestleZone over however many years to become known as WrestleZone's hardcore guy. What you need to remember is that just here in WrestleZone, I've had tables matches, ladder matches, I've had street fights. I've been in and won 2 Halloween brawls. But if we go further afield, I've had street fights. I've had TLC matches, tables, ladders. I've had death matches in every country on the British Isles. Let's bring it right back down to that first little bit, WrestleZone, where we both started. Because at Halloween Hijinks, it's WrestleZone. It's the Halloween brawl. It's Mickey Vago versus Lost Boy Aspen. And you can make your nice wee video with all your wee song puns and your musical puns, but the only music that's going to be playing at the end of Halloween Hijinks is Lost Boy Aspen's custom entrance music that he paid a lot of money for.
That was nice. There's a lot. It's a bit of a strange one here. Lost Boy Aspen versus Mickey Vago. Halloween brawl. It's your second Halloween brawl. This will not be your fun Halloween brawl. This will not be the... I don't think this will be the one where it's going to probably...
Uno.
This is your trick of the evening, where we're going to see some wicked games. We're going to see... We've seen what Aspen can do in WrestleZone when this stipulation has been put into effect with his match with Zach Dynamite last year, which I still think my back hurts thinking of that body slam on the rim of a bin.
Oh, mate. No, come on now. Flashbacks.
So we've seen what he's willing to do to try and get a hold of a title. What's he willing to do to defend the title? And we've seen what Vago can do as well. We've seen his mosh pit match with Archer at Aberdeen Anarchy. He's willing to go above and beyond as well to settle a score, to defend a title, to do whatever he needs to do. He's got that mist as well at his disposal. So yeah, it's one of those where I'm going to watch it and go, another one, much like a Tri-Counties Championship match. Aspen's my guy. Everyone knows this. I don't think it's a secret. But again, it's Vago who's put in the work since the shows have returned. He did things during the pandemic to keep WrestleZone name alive through the mosh pit. He did all that kind of thing. And he came in very amazing shape, won the Tri-Counties Championship, had a great reign with that, had that series with Chris Archer. He's a guy that probably has earned an undisputed WrestleZone championship run and be a triple crown champion. But again, I wouldn't want to see it at the expense of Aspen, who's had a fantastic reign already. It's a very emotional match for me, I think, as a fan, that I'm going to be coming into this particular match. So be prepared. If my back's not to you trying to ear into the commentary, I might be in a bit of a state in that match itself. But Your thoughts?
You've hit every button there. I think it's not often that we see a match that comes about this way, a rematch that was signed on the night of the first encounter. That was unusual in itself, and obviously there were extenuating circumstances about the old disputed finish of that wrestling match there. Mickey Vago put on the performance of a lifetime. Fight of his life. And he didn't win the championship, but a lot of people left Battle of the Nations thinking he should have. And I don't think a year ago we would have said that about a Mickey Vago Lost Boy Aspen match. Now, since lockdown, yes, Mickey Vago has excelled. Tri-County's champion, mosh pit matches, turning back all comers. Last year in WrestleZone 2022, we went through one of the most tangled web of feuds, whatever word you want to use, around that undisputed championship. You had Damien, you had Zach Dynamite in the Foundation of the Future, and you had the Lost Boy. And that took up basically an entire year. Those guys, one way or another, smashing each other's heads in, like we saw last year at the Halloween Brawl with Zach Dynamite and Lost Boy Aspen. Did that mean that people like the Heavy Metal Hooligan had to take a back seat for a little while and had time to think about it a little bit more, to get all their ducks in a row? Cliche at the wall, call it what you will. Did that mean they had more prep time? They let those three, and especially Dynamite and Aspen, tear lumps out of each other. Who knows if they're the same now after all those wars? Will Mickey Vago capitalize on that? Now, I know Aspen's been champion for a long time now. He just passed 300 days not long ago. In 10 months now, that's a hell of a run. One of the longest reigns in WrestleZone history. But Mickey Vago is ready, and he showed that in August. And with a Halloween brawl, that means the cane is legal. Any of those mosh pit weapons, if he Halloweens them up, they're going to be legal. Vago's no stranger at Halloween Brawl. He's been here before, maybe not to the devastating depths that Aspen had last year, but he's been here before. And that could be very telling. How ready is Aspen for this? A very different Mickey Vago, an amped up Mickey Vago. Now, I know things between them, they're a little bit more amicable, you know. They've been at loggerheads in the past. Now it's a little bit more mutual respect, I think. At least on the surface, that's what it appears. We'll see what kind of fight we get out of both guys. I think Aspen's going to have to bring it to turn back Mickey Vago on Saturday night.
Yeah, I mean, if three pile drivers still had Vago with the wherewithal to put his foot on a bottom rope, I think Aspen's going to have to kill him. That's kind of that's possibly what Vago is anticipating as well.
Well, I know that Aberdeen Royal Infirmary is just down the street from Curl Aberdeen, but please let's keep it all above board here, gentlemen.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. Well, that's what we're kind of in agreement with as well. I'm just writing what notes I've got. Battle Nation rematch. We've covered that. I've written down a word I cannot decipher. That's not good.
Excellent.
We've got Vago Triple Crown, which we've touched upon, mosh pit experience, which you mentioned as well. So, yes, it's one of those where, again, much like I was saying, much like with the Tri-Counties match, it's more my head and my heart going that yeah, I've watched Vago grow since the Crows returned, and he's become one of the most popular wrestlers on the roster. But yeah, it's just seeing Aspen lose, and that's what I don't want to see either. So yeah, it's gonna be a very strange night.
I don't want to come across like I'm putting too much faith behind, no pun intended, behind the challengers and our two singles championship matches. Ronan King and Mickey Vago are excellent. Mm-hmm. Caleb Valhalla and the Lost Boy are two of the best. Two of the absolute best that you will see around on any show you go to right now. They are champions for a reason. They deserve to be there. I'm just saying that every challenge that comes their way is going to be harder than the last one. Absolutely. Aspen found that out in August. He's got to turn back Mickey Vago again. Has he got it in him to do that? Absolutely. I hope for him. I hope for his sake that he does. I hope for Vago's sake that he doesn't. I know for my sake and your sake, we're going to enjoy it either way. Well, maybe you won't. I don't know. You know, you'll be hiding under your chair.
won't be as bad as Anarchy last year. That was, I think I sweated more than I mean, Northern Hotel was already quite warm as it is, but I think I sweated a puddle of my body weight. It felt like not in that way. There was a rumor about a chair that wasn't me, but it's gonna be one of those nights. But just to lighten up the mood before we kind of do the aftermath and maybe touch upon Stonehaven, in the most respectful way. Totally. Halloween brawls and Halloween weapons. How do you constitute as a legal weapon? And I'm not talking about tables. If anyone's gonna start sure. talking about legality of tables. How do you constitute a Halloween weapon? Does it have to be orange and black? As long as it's colorful as in orange kind of color. What? How do you? Have you done Halloween brawls? Have you looked at weapons? Maybe, and went, that's a Halloween brawl weapon.
From memory, when I was in one of these things, basically, if there was something lying around, I considered it fair game.
Right.
If I could grab it and use it, I would go with it. And if somebody was going to stop me, then, you know, they can try. I think you might be onto something. It's less of a grey area and more of an orange and black area. What even do you consider Halloween themed? That it could be anything. Probably the only thing I would say, Christmas trees are out. That's definite. Easter eggs, no. Valentine's cards, if you're finding them at this time of year, you're a better man than me. Halloween-wise, have at it. I'm glad I'm not one of our officials. And I don't mean to get you set off. I know you're on their case and how dare you, sir. But if I'm Dennis Law, or if I'm Mikey Innes or any of the Cabala referees that they help train up, I'm glad it's on them and not on me. I'll just enjoy seeing it.
I was ready. I was on the edge there. But
you mentioned the body slam on the body slam on the bin last year. That trash can. Is that Halloween legal?
That's it.
I mean, I suppose you've got to throw things away at Halloween. But
yeah, I mean, cookie sheets, like baking trays, absolutely understand. Halloween treats, cookies, that all makes sense to my brain. But yeah, but things like bins, like, yeah, I suppose you throw out stuff afterwards, but then
I'm going to have to give you the cop-out answer here, Billy, and just say referee's discretion, my friend.
I'll be watching you, Dennis. I'll be watching you. Wow, right. Anyway, right. So that's the show wrapped up there for Halloween Hijinks. Tickets are sold out, so we just talked about a show for an hour.
Thank you very much for that. If you're coming along, we never, ever, ever look past an advanced sellout. Thank you so much for all the support that you give the guys.
So just before we wrap up then, we'll just quick word about Saturday, November 4th. Tickets are now on sale for the Station Hotel in Stonehaven. Don't get confused and end up in Aberdeen. It's Stonehaven. First a match. I went to Italy. First match has been announced as a fatal four-way. We've got Conor Malloy, Mickey Vago, Omar Mohammed, and Captain Alan Sterling. I assume that if Mickey Vago is triumphant at Halloween Hijinks, this may be a title opportunity, maybe a title match for the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. Just initial thoughts on this match and a return to Stonehaven.
Possibly an unexpected championship opportunity on the go for the other three guys, or maybe Mickey Vago moves into something else. As is always put down, folks, card subject to change, and I think Mickey Vago's going to have a say about that come this Saturday night. But yes, always good to be back in Stonehaven. Been looking to get back there ever since lockdown times. It's been a really, really good town for WrestleZone in the past. This match is another crazy one. Is they like Connor and Omar in the same match going at it. That's worth the price of admission by itself, isn't it?
Absolutely. That's going to be a phenomenal match. Unfortunately, I won't be at that show, so I will do a preview of it.
But, I'm leaving.
I know.
Come on back. It's fine.
So hopefully it's an hour sellout. If there's one ticket left, then I can only apologize that's probably one I would have bought. But
I'll bill you for it anyway. It's all right.
I'm going to see the fireworks with my son. So unfortunately,
well, we'll let you off
there. But if he cries, then I'll point at him and go, "I could have been at the wrestling tonight. I could have been at the wrestling, and you're crying." But anyway, I wouldn't do that. That'd be silly. But anyway,
you're going to be seeing actual fireworks, and I'm going to be seeing the fireworks that the four men in that match provide.
There we go. Remember the 4th of November, Stonehaven. Go get your tickets at ringsideworld.co.uk. But this has been
I'll remember it because I'll have to be there.
Okay. Obviously, yeah, of course. Hopefully there's no stairs. This has been phenomenal. Just fancy dress contest as well. Have you got your costume already?
I wear a mask all the time. What am I supposed to do?
Yeah, Mr. Wrestles or mask?
Would you want to be mistaken for him?
Anyway, we'll move
on. Like Tucker and Dawkins, you never know.
But all things, I've got my costume. I'm going to have to do some editing to my costume because there's a naughty word on the T-shirt. But I don't think I'll be winning I don't think I'll be winning any competitions anytime soon.
You're coming dressed as Ronan King this year.
Oh, yeah, I'm absolutely going to pull that off. But this has been a phenomenal preview of Halloween Hijinks. I've really enjoyed this. It's better than speaking for an hour to myself about a show that's coming up that hopefully someone will listen to. At least I know that I've been speaking to someone, hopefully. If not, if I hit end record and you've never been there, that's going to freak me out a little bit.
You've been talking to someone. That's more for you, really.
I know, yeah. So before we go, one final thing. What's your pick? Match of the night?
Oh, he sprung this one on me. It depends what you're looking for. Are you looking for reckless abandon? Are you looking for who knows who's going to come out of this walking? Then you're looking at a six-man tag team war. If you're looking for, I think we called it the same earlier, if you're looking for fast-paced, high-flying, high-octane, Malloy versus Gray. If you're looking for a young man who might crown his career to date with the biggest win of his life against a guy who is one of the best in the country right now and everyone loves him for very good reason, you're looking at Caleb versus Ronan. There's so many to choose from. And that's not even touching on two Halloween brawls. Two!
It's going to be a phenomenal night. I'm in the same boat. I've got one matches that I'll be superly emotionally invested in. I'm looking forward to see Judas Gray for the first time wrestling live, and that's going to be a phenomenal match. And yeah, those Halloween brawls, they're going to be one, like I say, trick or treat on the line of what you'll possibly see for them. Yeah. But it's going to be a phenomenal.
If you want an answer out of me, I'm going to say our VIP bonus triple threat match: Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden, and Chris Archer, because hopefully at that point of the evening, I've still got my voice left.
Perfect. Well, if you see Blee Thunder at any WrestleZone event, it's up to him where he wants, whether he wants to speak to you. But if not, enjoy Halloween Hijinks. It's going to be a phenomenal night. Go follow WrestleZone on all the social medias. And in the meantime, yeah, Saturday, we're going to do a road trip episode. Hopefully my phone will actually stay upright and you won't get a nice close-up of my crotch like it did for Veruri. Hopefully I might be able to catch some of you guys before the show. I haven't asked management as yet if I can do so, but hopefully we can do that, and it's going to be a great night. So thank you very much again. Thank you.
No, thank you very much, Billy. It's been a pleasure to talk about the show. I'm pumped up for it now, so if I do lose my voice before Saturday, blame him.
Wonderful. Well, thanks again.